Boxing Day football has already brought us plenty of goals, Kay Marie. Stevie Nicol here with you. We're going to start with that Brentford-Spurs game, Stevie. It finished 2-2. It had to be another Spurs comeback. It seems as though they've picked up where they left off, bad first half, having come back in the second half. Is this just who they are now?
Well, it seems to be. The truth is, you have to point the finger at the coach. You have to point the finger at Conte. You know, this has happened too often for it not to be him sending his team out in pretty much a conservative mindset, because that's what they do. I mean, it's all very well to say, you know, we need to keep a good shape and we don't want to cut out of position and let's start the game nice and solid and don't take too many chances early on. Those are all good things to say to your team, but when you're continually stepping on the field and actually backing off as opposed to doing all these things, then you find yourself losing goals. And again, 2-0 down, and all of a sudden after 60 minutes, a completely different team, a team that had no choice but to go forward. And my goodness, the last 30 minutes, they absolutely annihilated Brentford. Harry Kane with the force. Actually, probably should have had a penalty before that. And then Højbjerg with the second, and all of a sudden, there seems like there's only one team going to win this game, and they almost did. Harry Kane hitting the crossbar. So, listen, you can't play for 30 minutes in a 90-minute game. And right now, that's kind of what Spurs are doing. And it seems to be the last 30.
Yeah, we'll get to some of those decisions in a minute. You mentioned that penalty that Spurs were denied. So with that in mind, you've got one coach who's had a 2-0 lead at home and given it up. And you've got another coach who's had this second half comeback, a fight back from his side, but only come away with a point. Which coach is happier after this game?
Listen, if you're 2-0 down away from home and you come back and get something, you should be happy. Yes, as I said, he won't be happy with the way they started. He won't be happy that we're 2 down. But, you know, to get something from this game from seemingly an impossible position, because they didn't look as though, certainly after the penalty wasn't given, there looked no way back for Spurs. But from nowhere, they just changed gear and were absolutely outstanding. I guess you've got to be happy if you're Conte. At the same time, I think Brentford would have taken 2-2 before the game started.
So we'll get to that penalty decision in a moment, because just hearing you mention it, I can kind of guess which way you're going to go on that. But on Ivan Toney's goal, which was Brentford's second, Eric Dyer will not want to see that back, Stevie.
Yeah, you know, it's a lack of composure. You know, you always hear us talking about strikers when they're going through on goal, you know, looking to have composure and pick a spot. And defenders have to do similar things when they're making clearances. They have to be composed. They can't panic and have a wild swing, because that's exactly what Dyer's done. It's just a wild swing. A guy that was at the World Cup, I mean, seriously. So it's a horrible, horrible decision. And of course, Ivan Toney following in the flick and puts it home from a couple of yards. So, yeah, no question avoidable, but pretty much in tune with the way that Spurs were going about their business.
Yeah, you wonder if they had been a bit rattled, though, because just before that, as you mentioned earlier, Kane had denied what looked like a clear penalty. It was a hug from Ben Mee. Is that how you saw it?
Yeah, I find it incredible that anybody looking at that can, because what has to happen is the officials have to think that either this is an accident or Harry Kane has initiated the contact. You know, they must think that Harry Kane's the one that's initiated the hugging and the cuddling and whatever you want to call it. But for me, absolutely no way. This is Ben Mee getting caught out of position. He's on the wrong side of Harry Kane. And really has no choice but to try and put Harry Kane off. But of course, when he does that, it really should have been so clear that it was a penalty. But somehow, it wasn't given. Incredible.
Harry Kane did score anyway. Obviously, this was his return after that fateful quarter-final for England in the World Cup, where he scored and missed a penalty. It was a really nice header from him today. What did you make of his performance?
It was kind of typical Harry Kane. You know, he started up top, and the longer that Spurs were up against it, he kept dropping deeper and deeper and trying to put some through balls, particularly to Son and Kulishevsky and Perisic on that other side. But things just didn't things weren't working for him or Spurs, to be honest. As I said, up until 60 minutes. And of course, Harry Kane's header, beautiful header, times it perfectly, right off the meat of the bat, back across the goalkeeper into the top corner. I mean, just textbook stuff. And Spurs are back in the game. So, yeah, listen, if your centre forward scores a goal every time he steps on the field, he's done his job.
Yeah, and then Hjøiber scored. He stood out today, didn't he?
Yeah, but he's a type of guy that likes to get his sleeves rolled up and get stuck in. When you're playing against Brentford away from home, the only thing you know is that they're going to be physical and they're going to be at you. They're going to try and put you off any way they can, as I said, particularly the physical side. And Højbjerg likes that. Yes, he can pass the ball. And of course, it was a great finish, the second goal. Picked his spot. Again, didn't panic. Just looked up and stuck it in the side net. And so, yeah, Højbjerg, of all the Spurs players, had a good game.
So there's a couple of things that needs to be talked about when it does come to January, because you mentioned Kulusevski. It was him and Bentancur who actually came in the January transfer window for Spurs. And they changed a lot. And I suppose that showed Antonio Conte the importance, and Spurs, because we know Antonio Conte is always going to want new players, the importance of getting important players in that January transfer window. They're going to have to bring a few in, aren't they?
I would suggest they have to bring players in at the back. I don't think there's an awful lot wrong with what they've got going forward. You know, when Richarlison's fit, that's a front line you've got. Richarlison, Kane, Son, Kulusevski on one side, you've got Perisic on the other side, Betancourt in the middle of the park making passes. So for me, the biggest thing Spurs have to do, in my opinion, is to show things up defensively. You know, we're talking about them giving goals away. Well, a real tight defence doesn't step on the field and give goals away nine times in a row. That tells you where your problem is. And the fact that Spurs always do seem to come back tells you that they can't score goals. So for me, it's clear. Yes, listen. Would you like to get a superstar to play up front with Harry Kane? Yes, of course you would. But at the end of the day, I think their troubles are more to do with what goes on defensively than what they have going forward.
You do wonder what's going to happen with Antonio Conte then, Stevie. The talk is that he has resumed contract talks to stay on at Spurs. Is it the right decision for him to stay on there? And is it the right decision for the club if that is to be the case?
Well, I definitely think it's the right decision for the club. And he must think it's the right decision for himself as well. It would suggest that he is going to be given funds, whether it's this January window or whether it's next summer, remains to be seen. I think there's no question that they do need strengthening, particularly at the back. But the fact that he's now talking with them about a contract tells you that he's in it for the long haul. He's certainly not going anywhere at the end of this season, I don't believe. And it would suggest, as I said, that they're going to back him in the transfer window, whichever one it may be. So, yeah, I think it's a good move for Spurs. And obviously, Conte thinks it's a good move for himself.
A nice little segue when you said he's not going anywhere. It looks as though Newcastle are not going anywhere. A 3-0 win over Leicester. They have picked up where they left off, and some wondered, was it a bad time for the World Cup break to come? Because obviously they'd been on a fine run. Some of the fans were fearing that it might stop that momentum. But looking at them today, it definitely didn't.
No, it didn't. And you can only beat what's put in front of you. And Leicester in that first half were pretty pathetic. But Newcastle cut them apart. I think Newcastle would love to play Leicester every week. You know, the one thing about Leicester is they're a nice football team. That's what they are. They're a nice football team. They play pretty football. And when they're on their day, they can outpass anybody. The problem for me is Leicester don't have any real strength to go with the ability to pass the ball around. And if you look at Newcastle, they've actually got a bit of everything. You know, they've got ability. They've got players like Almiron. And Willock coming in late into the box. You've got strength up front and Woods holding it up for those two to make those late runs. I mean, they've got the biggest left back in world of football and Bonds. And generally, I mean, Joe Linton, where did this come from? This guy has taken his game just to a completely different level. So Listen, if you want to try and play football against Newcastle, they'll give you a game. If you want to try and fight them, they'll give you a game. And today we saw a Leicester side who wanted to play football against them and couldn't handle them, but also couldn't handle them from a physical point of view as well, i.e. the third goal from Joe Linton, just complete mismatch in the penalty box. So yeah, Newcastle look as though they aren't going anywhere. Leicester, nice, pretty football team, but they can just try and stay up this year. But Newcastle, they got a chance. They got a chance at the top four.
I mean, at the time of recording, they're actually second in the Premier League, which is just incredible to see. Who would have known it? You mentioned Miguel Almiron. That's 8 goals in his last 9 Premier League games. What a goal that was today as well. What do you think of him as a player?
Well, of all the players at Newcastle, we were, I guess we'd be thinking, is Almiron the one that this World Cup break is going to harm the most? But took him, what, 10 minutes to play a nice little 1-2, beautiful little touch. Second one set him up, and then the composure just to roll the ball in the bottom corner. So, again, I mentioned Joe Linton earlier, taking his game up a level. There's no question, Almiron's done the same, and it's amazing what confidence does for you. You know, it's one thing to have ability, but to just be able to go and play and be free and be confident, Almiron's a perfect example of that.
How much of a miss is James Maddison on the other side of things for Leicester?
Well, of course, he's a quality player. But again, you know, he's just another part of a pretty football team that plays nice football. But I'm never going to win anything other than a pretty game of football. So, yeah, of course, you're going to miss quality of Maddison. But I don't think he would have any say in what happened today in this game.
Okay, last question. Would you bet against Newcastle finishing in the top four?
That's a tough one. I mean, you know, you look at the, you know, they're bringing Jacob Murphy on. Jacob Murphy's an up and coming young player. You got Sam Maximan coming on as well. They've got some strength and depth. I mean, will they strengthen as well in this January window? We don't know. It really is 50-50. I wouldn't back against them. I'm sorry, I can't answer that.
Okay, so if you just had to answer now who your top four would be, that's probably the best way to do it, because then you'll see if Newcastle are in there.
Well, the problem is you've got to think that Liverpool, Chelsea, Man United, you've got to think that they're going to change gear and start winning a load of games in a row. So if that happens, then that's going to put pressure on Newcastle. Right now, there is no pressure on Newcastle whatsoever. They're just going along merrily, playing the football, getting it done, enjoying what they're doing, scoring goals. Fans are loving it. So right now, there's no pressure on them. You know, if you think of Leicester, I'm not sure if it was last year or the year before, you know, they found themselves in third place, really comfortable, and blew it. The pressure just got too much for them. So I would suggest the only thing that stands in Newcastle's way of not being in the top four is if towards the end of the season they start looking at the table and start thinking about it, and then the pressure starts building. But saying that, that means that Liverpool, Chelsea and Man United are going to have to change gear, as I said, and start winning games in a row.
Yeah, well, we'll definitely see. It's Leeds up next for them at home and then Arsenal away. So maybe that will tell us a bit more about Newcastle.
Well, thank you very much for watching ESPN on YouTube. For more sports highlights and analysis, be sure to download the ESPN app. And for live streaming, premium content, and let's not forget as well, ESPN FC 7 days a week. Subscribe to ESPN Plus.